Pete Daly, U.S. Naval Institute. Welcome to our panel session with the systems commanders or people representing the system commander portfolio. Our moderator today is Vice Admiral Dave Dunaway. And the question I have for the audience is, who is Dave Dunaway? First, there is Dave Dunaway, the engineer. Second, there's Dave Dunaway, the strike fighter pilot. Third, there is Dave Dunaway, the test pilot. And his test assignments included the A-12, the F-18. He also had a tour as the F-18EF operational test director with VX-9, where he flew more than 200 developmental test missions and was selected as test pilot of the year. Fourth, there is Dave Dunaway, the acquisition guy. He served in multiple program management assignments. And finally, there's Dave Dunaway, the leader and the commander. He commanded Naval Air Warfare Center, Weapons Division, China Lake, Point Magoo. He commanded Navy's Operational Test and Evaluation Force. And in September 2012, he became the commander of Naval Air Systems Command, Pax River. Admiral Dunaway left active duty in October 2015, is now an independent civilian consultant. But I remember him most on active duty as the man who got the attention of Navy leadership on firing chains and the need for integration and interoperability, as well as the need for some threat-based analysis in the chaos of a capabilities-driven requirements process. We've got an esteemed panel here today who the moderator will introduce, but for now, let's welcome the moderator, Vice Admiral Dave Decoy Dunaway.
I don't know who that dude was, but this is about the peak of the talent on the show, so we're going to stop right now. What? Thank you, Pete. All right, so I'm going to go through quick introductions of each of our panel members, and then I'm going to give you a quick three-minute framing. Might be a little inflammatory, but maybe not. And then we're going to hear 3 minutes or so from each of the panelists, and then I'm hopeful that we'll have a whole series of questions, because we all believe that that's probably the most entertaining part about all this is the Q&A from the crowd. So first on the panel is Vice Admiral Tom Moore, the NAVC Systems Commander. He's 81 grad of the Naval Academy. You can read his whole bio. He's got a lot of postgraduate degrees. He's a surface nuke by trade and an engineering duty officer. Spent a lot of time working with Tom. He's very calm. He's very rational, very personable style, and I think you'll find it a good way to start the panel today. Next to him is Dave Lewis. Dave is the commander of Spaywar Syscom. He's a 79 graduate of some university in Nebraska. I don't know which one that is.
Only one
university in Nebraska. He's got a postgraduate degree from Navy Postgraduate School, a surface warfare officer as well, and has been all things surface combat systems and surface maintenance for the Navy for a long time, very intimately involved with all the combat systems. He's a highly experienced acquisition guy, probably the long in the tooth acquisition guy around now, I think. Yeah, maybe. Maybe he's been doing it a long time. Next is Rear Admiral Bruce Baffer from the United States Coast Guard. He's the Assistant Commander for Engineering Logistics and 84 grad of the United States Coast Guard Academy. He wins the Postgraduate Degree Award with 4. So he's a dedicated overachiever, as you can tell. He's very operational in his history and career. He's got years in acquisition. He's a gentleman. I've known him for quite some time, and I've had the pleasure of knowing that his son and my son went to Naval Academy together, and that's really where I met Bruce, and they're a fine family, and I'm really happy to have him on the panel. Next, Rear Admiral Bullet Miller from N98. He is a much more handsome and powerful stand-in for Admiral Grossglags, who could not make this event today as the commander of Nav Air, but I think it's a great addition to have a requirements person in the group and somebody who's closer connected with the operators and brings that forward. An 81 graduate of the United States Naval Academy, a couple of postgraduate degrees, A7, F-18, tremendous amount of operational experience, commanded carriers, commanded strike groups, just the real deal when it comes to how the warfighters work in naval aviation. And I think he's the perfect conduit and connection, and I also have had a lifetime of career encounters with Bullet Miller, and I find him to be one of the finest humans I know. Next, Brigadier General Joe Shrader from R4 SISCOM enlisted to flag ranks, and that in and of itself means a lot. He was an artillery officer back in the day, and still has his hearing, which is really unusual. He's got a postgraduate degree, he's a classic Marine career, and he's the commander of the MAR-4 SISCOM. And I think this is as a group, I think the MAR-4 SISCOM does more with less than just about anybody I've seen, especially in the world of their digital interoperability. Okay, so that's your panel. And basically, as I kick off, I think back to the conversations I heard from Admiral Stavridis, from Admiral Harris, and from Admiral Winnefeld. And basically what they said is, Rome is burning. And I'm not sure that everybody really captured those clear points from their conversation. We're in a real problem. We are very effective where we are today. But as you look out to the future, which is what this panel is about, preparing for the future, are we on the right track? I think what got us here today is not going to get us where we need to be in the future. So I like to read about civilizations, and when I read about them, I find that they fail for a number of reasons that might sound familiar to you. They get incredibly bureaucratic. There's a fair amount of corruption that occurs in their bureaucracies. They get vested in huge amounts of infrastructure that they can't maintain and sustain, and that is too expensive to update. And they're run by a bunch of lemmings. Anybody know what a lemming is? That's a little animal that follows all the other lemmings and does exactly what all the other lemmings say. So those are the four things that make civilizations fail. Remember, the greatest navy in the world in 1900 was the British Navy, right? That wasn't that long ago. We have to be incredibly careful to make sure that it's not us that's going down that path for our future force. I sit here and look at what we've done, and we have soaring costs. We get $500 to $600 billion a year and can't manage with that. We're not keeping up in terms of deployments and modernization like we would like to. We've undercut some of our infrastructure. You know, we get strike fighter pilots getting 12 hours a month, right? So we're not making it work with a lot of money. We're slow to respond. It takes 12 years to get a program of record. So I think that there's some real issues that as we look forward that this august group has really got to pay attention to in order for us to do it differently and to be much more effective. Instead of getting 30 cents on the dollar, you got to get 60 cents on the dollar. Now, I believe that all of these problems are technically feasible to be done. I think organizationally, they're nearly impossible. So that is the preamble that I think should set the stage for the conversation today. We really have to do something different as we go forward in the future, because doing it evolutionarily like we have been is going to send us very much down the same path we've been on. So with that, I will hand it over to my esteemed counterpart, Tom Moore.
Okay, it's working. So thanks, Decoy. You know, when we came up here, Decoy says, hey, you get 3 minutes to talk. And my first thought was, and I just flew all the way out from Washington, D.C., and I'm going to take a ride back tonight, and I only get to talk for 3 minutes. And, you know, I was reminded of a dinner conversation once that Winston Churchill had, and his guest speaker was complaining to Winston Churchill about, how am I possibly going to tell the audience everything I know in 3 minutes? And Winston Churchill replied to him, sir, my advice to you would be to speak slowly. So I am going to try and keep it here to 3 minutes. I do agree Rome is burning, but as being a long-term acquisition guy, I think there's a tendency sometimes we want to point our fingers at the acquisition process itself as it's the root of all evil. And let me offer up that acquisition by itself is not the problem. It certainly has some issues that we need to work, but if you're talking about the speed to the fleet and driving costs down, and you're going to focus only on the acquisition system, the acquisition process, you're probably missing some opportunity here. So I think it gets to requirements definition. It gets to building platforms that have the capability to grow and expand over time. and it needs to get, we need to have a little bit of appetite suppression. The thing I would offer up to you is that as we move forward here, and I agree with all the premises that DK laid out there, is we got to make sure we don't relearn some of the lessons of the past. In 1990, at the height of the Reagan buildup, we had 586 ships. At that time, we had in NAVC 05, my technical organization, we had almost 1,300 ship design engineers and technical oversight people. By 2005, we were down to 285 ships, and we were down to 251 people in headquarters providing technical oversight of our ships. And during that time period between 1990 and 2005, it was also the same time that we designed and built LCS, we designed and built DDG-1000, we designed and started the build of the Ford, we designed and built LPD-17, and designed and built Virginia-class submarine. So I would offer up to you that while speed and cost are certainly something we need to focus on, that the way to not do that is to completely cut out the government oversight and expertise and throw things over the fence to industry and say, hey, build me this and send it back to me. There's a better way to do this going forward. I agree with Decoy 100%. We've got to figure out how to align ourselves with industry, not relearn the lessons of the past, and also remember that government does add some value on the acquisition side of the house if you want to get the best product to the hands of the warfighter as quickly as possible and at the lowest possible cost. So with that, I'll turn it over to Dave.
Wow, that was good. In the C4I world, we bought boxes, and then somebody wired up the boxes, and hopefully it worked. In the future, we need to buy systems that have defined capabilities, and they do, in fact, contain boxes. And that's the essence of what I'd like to talk about now, is a force of the future has to be a system-level procurement in the C4I arena. We already do that in Aegis. We already do it in a lot of other areas in the Navy. It's not new to the Navy. It's not new to acquisition. It's new to the C4I world. In order to do that, we have to have the things that the other communities have, which is well-defined architectures, well-defined standards, that government part of the equation where the government knows what the government's buying, the government understands what's happening, we're technically competent, and we can buy it as a system completely from industry. We can buy the bits from industry. That's a choice we can make depending on the level of sophistication of the problem. One thing I like to say for C4I in particular is if you're doing a C4I install and you're using an oxyacetylene torch, you have made a fundamental mistake somewhere, okay? And we do that every single time. C4I install ought to be an over-the-air install, ideally. Maybe a CD install. Maybe you bring a rack in and you use a torque wrench to install it, or a drawer. The minute you light an arc or hit a flame, now you're tied to CNO availabilities. Now you're tied to a correct and good ship main process to make sure everything is safe and appropriate. And that carries a lot of baggage with it, and it slows us down. It's all about the apps. It's about software, not about the hardware. Right now, we bundle hardware and software together. We use oxyacetylene torches. So we need to unbundle our software and our hardware. We need to unbundle our software. We need to be able to do continuous deliveries of software. If you're a medical software program manager in the government and you want to update your program every 2 weeks, you should be able to do that. Right now, that takes 7 years to do that because you're tied to a CNO availability. All the applications should have backward compatibility. So right now, if you install a new system, all the old systems don't work anymore. Just like your smartphone that you have, you put in a new Maps program or you put in a new application, that doesn't invalidate your phone. It doesn't change anything else for you, except it does update that one program. That's where we're going in the C4I world. That's where we need to go in the future so that we can be updating our systems annually or every 18 months on a regular basis. That's the only way we can keep up with the level of innovation that's required. That's the only way we can stay ahead of the cybersecurity threat in our world. We're never going to patch and scan our way out of a cybersecurity problem. we're going to modernize our way out of a cybersecurity problem. That's the only way to do that. And if we're taking 7, 8, 9, 10 years to modernize our C4I systems, we will fail. And we need to fundamentally change our business in order to stay ahead of the state of the art and the threat. And that's all I've got. Thank you.
All right, so one of Admiral Dunaway's entering premises is that we're winning through brute force spending. I just want to get it on the record that the Coast Guard has never won through brute force spending. Not that we're above it. We just have never had that opportunity. When it comes to procuring the force of the future, though, the problem we have, and he mentioned the acquisition process, we've all seen the Defense Acquisition University Systems Engineering flowchart, that big, huge process diagram. The problem we get into with that is we think it's one size fits all, and that's great if you're trying to build an aircraft carrier or an icebreaker, but we get it confused and we try to use it for procurement and modernization and things that it really isn't appropriate for. And it gets us mired in bureaucracy and excessive oversight, and then even small things take forever. So that's where we need to go, is using the right tool for the job when it comes to acquisition process. The DAU answer is, will you tailor it? Well, unless you're building the whole platform, it probably doesn't need to be tailored. It needs to be blown up. And we need to use the right tool for the job, for experimentation, for a more risk-tolerant environment where we can do those modernization upgrades in an environment that can accommodate risk and failure. But once you get into the major acquisition, and that's the big A world where you're developing the whole new product, it's a risk-averse culture. We've got a whole generation of disciples who have been trained to be risk-averse. I'm one of them. DAU has produced them. That's okay when you're building big steel, but when you're doing the C4ISR upgrades and the hardware upgrades and the software upgrades, they've got to be plug and play. They got to be more flexible and more adaptive. Otherwise, it just takes too long, and we get burdened in the bureaucracy. Thank you.
Where do you take risk? So, is that working? Thank you. So as a decoy, I'll have to pass to G8 that your comments about his handsomeness and powerfulness, I think he'll appreciate it. I appreciate being on this panel. So the space that I operate in is kind of, as the requirements officer for Naval Aviation, the link between the fleet, the requirements, and the acquisition community. So I'm in the camp that kind of fits between both, and I appreciate Admiral Davidson's comments at lunch. I'm in the camp that says, yeah, we need to procure the force of the future, but we need to recover the readiness of our current force first. So the title of this, are we on the right track to do both? I think yes, we're on the right track. Why do I say that? Things like accelerated acquisition board of directors, MACO, Maritime Advanced Capabilities Office. Look at what we're doing with MQ-25 and LDUUV. We've reorganized the OPNAV staff to where now where Office of Naval Research, Dave Hahn's organization, N94, is under the high nines, such that we have a need requirement from the high nines and a solution from the technical community at ONR. We marry that together and we monitor our programs from birth all the way through end of life. That's all goodness. The other thing is there's a realization, to Admiral Dunaway's point, that how we've been behaving isn't how we need to behave in the future. And what it boils down in my simple mind is programs right now take too long and they cost too much. So that realization is there. So what are we going to do about it? Well, we need to change our culture. We need to get out of buying things at min sustain rate and not taking advantage of economic order quantity. We need to team with industry sooner in the process. And when I say team, it's teaming from requirements and then teaming all the way through development and throughout the life of the program. So that's changing how we're doing business.
The other thing I'll tell you is we need, you know, support of Congress. When we change something, we want to take a different tack to getting to it. We need their support to say, yeah, we see the innovative nature of what you're trying to do, and we support it. And with those kind of things in place, I think we can generate the force that we need to with our current forces and build the force of the future. Thanks.
So, good afternoon. So just 2 points. I'm just going to, you know, where I sit, where I live every day is at the tactical level. And, you know, we're coming through a period of where we've once again visiting acquisition reform, and we had NDAA 2016 came out with some pretty robust things with regard to acquisition reform. But once you boil all that down, I think it comes down to things at the tactical level. First, the Admiral mentioned leadership. It absolutely, leadership matters. And it matters, you know, at our program management level, we got to have the right people in the right place. That's the first thing. The second thing is I often hear from my requirements counterparts, we got to get on contract, we got to get on contract. I would offer that we can get on contract, and we can get on contract pretty quickly. The problem is getting to the point where we can get to getting on contract. Case in point is just recently I had leadership come to me, said, hey, come back to me and tell me what it would look like if the Marine Corps were to take this opportunity that may be presented with a new administration to upgrade or go after a new armored reconnaissance capability. Our light armored reconnaissance vehicle was fielded in 1984. We've got 7 different models, but the first one was fielded in 1984. For goodness sakes, we are right now running an obsolescence program. You know, how crazy is that? For a light armored vehicle, we're running an obsolescence program to keep that vehicle going. So I told the program manager, I said, go do that, come back to me. He came back to me with a schedule. And if you understand the timeline, milestone B is where you get into the engineering phase, down select to 2 and take them through engineering, almost 8 years to get us from capabilities analysis all the way to milestone B. 8 years. I mean, that's too long. So I sent him back and I said, take a look at what we did with ACV. And they took a look at what we've done with ACV, and I would offer to you, and I know this is not IT, this is platform-centric, but I think it's the mindset. I would offer that if you take a look at what we did with ACV, they went at it from a strategy of, we need to identify what are the requirements that are just adequate enough that allow us to put it out there, prototypes come in, we get on a milestone B EMD contract and move out. And we have done that. It took us about 2.5-3 years to get there. We did it based on four requirements that would allow us to get the basic vehicle and then spiral technology into that as it matures. So I would offer that. The second thing is for industry, and I'll close on this. Some points I would offer that we need from industry. The first one is deliver what you promise in the contract. It's got to be on time. It's got to be affordable within cost, and it's got to work. Just those simple things. There is no time for do-overs. We have no time for do-overs. The second thing is the system has got to be easy to operate and easy to maintain. If you come to us with a system that has a whole army of FSRs and a complex training apparatus that goes with it, it does us no good. I got to be able to forward deploy it, and it's got to be easy to operate. The last thing is we're going to want to purchase the tech data package. And the reason for that is there's 2 reasons. One is we're going to try to build the print so we can keep the cost down. Ammunition comes to mind. We can't keep on, you know, with 1 or 2 ammunition suppliers. They own the tech data package, and the price of ammunition just continues to skyrocket. I sat on this panel 2 years ago, and I talked about the price of artillery ammunition, how much it has gone up, some 600-700%. The last thing is 3D printing. We need tech data packages to do 3D printing. The Marine Corps right now, I mean, we're looking very hard at where applicable we would use 3D printers as a second source of supply. It only makes sense. 3D printing is on its is up and coming, and I think it's the way of the future when it comes to supply. So with that, I'll turn it over to Admiral Dunaway.
Okay, this is the point where we stand up here in awkward silence until somebody asks a question. So the quicker we get somebody up to the, actually, I have one. Oh, good.
Admiral Dunaway, Paul Norman from General Dynamics Electric Boat. I've heard the statements made before that we need to change our culture. I asked this leadership panel, what do we need to do combined between industry and the Navy to change our culture so that we can work as a team and move the ball forward?
That's a great question. Tom, this is a cultural shift.
Yeah. So I think we sometimes toss the culture word around too easily as if, okay, just change the culture. I do think that we have to recognize that there is a little bit of an existential threat right now, and we do have to create a greater sense of urgency in what we're trying to get accomplished. When I look at my workforce of 73,000 people every day, the vast majority of them want to come into work every single day and do great work. And in many reasons, it's not the culture as much as the fact that we have overlaid so many requirements on them of things that they have to do in order to get their job done. And I think we would be, my sense is we'd be better off focusing on the overly burdensome requirements that we put on the processes today that absolutely add zero value to the product that they're generating at the end of the day. I think if you do that, the turn circle will be faster, we'll learn quicker, we'll get product to the fleet faster, and then everybody will say, wow, look, NAVC changed its culture.
Okay, I'll take a shot at it. And again, I'm speaking from a C4I world, okay? In the C4I world, are we developing systems or are we integrating systems? And I believe most of the things we do, we are integrating systems together, off-the-shelf commercial equipment, processors, possibly radios, that kind of stuff. So milestone A, B, and C have already happened. They were done by industry. System engineering has already happened. It's been done by industry. PDRs and CDRs have already been completed by industry for their systems. So when we start a C4I development, what we're really doing is a C4I integration, but we start at milestone A because that's the way you're supposed to do it. I think most of our stuff should start at milestone C or later in order to take this developed and well-engineered system or this product and put it into a uniquely Navy, shipboard, military, aviation, ground environment. That's the integration piece. That's the secret sauce that we know that industry doesn't know. How do you take a Cisco server and put it on a ship and make it work with a 22-year-old sailor who's been in the Navy for 18 months and went to a 12-week school maintaining it, not somebody with a master's degree in computer science. That's a uniquely Navy problem. That's what we know. We obsess about the milestone A, B, and C stuff and the PDR stuff, and I think we should be obsessing about the integration bit and the military piece of it. So the culture change, and I agree there's a culture change, is what are we really doing and what unique assets do we require and what should we be doing as government folks to bring that product to the fleet?
Hey, before we get to the next question, Deco, I'd like to, there are a ton of examples we can use for culture. I'll give you one, the testing community. So I have a weapon system, pick a weapon system, and let's say I'm buying 200 of these weapons. Well, the test community is going to ask me to shoot 150 of them to validate every single possible scenario, environment, everything else that could happen to make sure that that weapon system gets to the 100% solution. So when we talk about rapid prototyping, learning on the fly, having agile systems that work across domains in any environment, you know, we need that ability to be able to have a common sense approach that changes the culture and say, okay, we're going to test to this level. We're going to field it. We're going to get it in the hands of sailors and Marines, and they're going to learn, and we continue to adapt as we move forward. We haven't done that very successfully thus far. So we're, as we try to inculcate and bring those types of systems and that approach to business, right, how we're doing business, how we're fielding stuff, that will take, over time, that will affect the culture as far as how we approach those kind of things.
Sir, I would just add is, I guess culture is a good word, but I would offer it's more of a, we need disruptive thinkers. And when I say that, I mean we need to, I talk to the Marines and the civilian Marines and Marine Corps Systems Command and say you need to attack the process that's laid out before you from the mindset of the process is there to serve your ends, not the other way around. The process is not the ends. The process is the means to get to the end. The end is the product being fielded to the Marine. So I think they need to approach it from a disruptive thinking mindset, asking whether or not the process is really serving the end that they're trying to accomplish. And I think that would lead to a cultural shift.
Bruce, did you want to add anything?
I think everything's been said, but not yet by everybody, so I'm not going to stick anything in here.
Yeah. So I will add one thing. There's models that have done this and done this well. We just choose not to do them. The RCO, Big Safari, Skunk Works. Every time you have a big bureaucracy, you pull the full process off to the side, you challenge it, and you embarrass it and beat it by doing the entire systems engineering process closed loop, confined, and rapidly. And we prove that it can be done, and then the culture consumes it back into the organization, right? So this has been repeated. My personal opinion, I've seen it a bunch of different times. We can do these rapidly, but the culture consumes it. So I don't know. I like your cultural comment. I'd blow it up. I'd blow the culture up. All right, next question. My personal opinion. Now that I'm not in uniform, I can say that.
Good afternoon. Thank you again for your time here. I'm Greg Butler. I'm from ServiceNow. Sir, I'm a retired Marine. I have a question from you on the perspective of when and how you think the Marine Corps might start to move to the commercial cloud, whether a hybrid solution or a holistic commercial cloud. Over.
So you heard Admiral Dunaway say that I'm an artillery officer. I was an enlisted grunt before that, but grunts are smart. So I go to meetings quite often, and sitting across from me is Brigadier General Krall, who is Director C4, and I hear them talk a lot about cloud, going to the cloud. So I think to answer your question, we're trying to get there, I think, yesterday. To be honest with you. How we get there, how we unhitch ourselves from legacy systems to get to there seems to be one question. And then the second one is it really seems to come down to a big data management issue. We've got so many systems out there right now that rely on, I heard the other day that on the logistics side of the house, that we'll have some 20-plus systems, and each one of them has some way, shape, or form, different way of entering a serial number on a vehicle. And so it's a data management issue, getting it to the point where we can do that. I don't know if that helps you.
Yes, sir.
I've managed body armor and those types of things. I'm not trying to say I don't understand the cloud stuff, but I don't understand it deep enough to really answer your question sufficiently, but we can get you an answer.
Yeah. Roger that. Thanks, sir.
Hi. Sydney Friedberg, Breaking Defense. One of the things that Admiral Winnefeld spoke about a lot this morning, and some of these are familiar themes, was the need to modernize rapidly by looking at payloads, vice platforms, think out of the box and so forth. I'm curious, and some of you have already touched on parts of this, how do you do that from where you sit, actually make those cool ideas reality? In particular, for those of you who build big platforms, how do you actually make sure they have the room to upgrade deliberately built in, be that standards or just physical swap available? And for those of you who build things that go on platforms, how do you make sure if those are as plug and play as possible.
Okay. You pushed my button there, Sydney. So I have a tale of two ships, the Imperial Japanese Navy ship Yamato and the USS Hornet. Both in World War II, same time, same war, different navies. Yamato would have won an acquisition prize. It was built in record time. It got the requirements exactly right. And had three Yamatos met four Iowa-class battleships in combat, the Yamatos would have won. The reason the Yamato was useless in World War II was because of those exact things. It wasn't flexible. It wasn't adaptable. Where'd you go? There you are. And the Hornet, on the other hand, had a flight deck and a hangar deck, and it had an air wing. And the air wing was almost completely independent of the ship. So after Pearl Harbor, President Roosevelt said, I want to strike Japan. All the ships that we had built to strike Japan were sitting on the bottom of the harbor in Pearl Harbor, and so we didn't have anything. And the admiral said, well, we can't do that. And he said, I don't care, I want you to do it. In 4 months, we figured out that you could put a bomber on the Hornet, and you could drive it within bomber range of Japan, and we drop bombs on Tokyo. 4 months. Land-based bombers from a ship did a strike against the homeland of Japan. And that's flexibility and agility, and it's driven by having a platform in that case, which has an open architecture, and it has a weapon system which can be changed easily and rapidly, clearly defined interfaces. You need this much wind, you got this much flight deck, that kind of stuff. And those aircraft carriers, the reason they're the weapon they are today is because they are open architecture, modular, with a changeable weapon system, and can be flexed literally at a moment's notice. And that's why they are the most powerful ships in the world today. And that's why we don't build Yamatos anymore.
You could be the next PEO carriers. That's well said.
Sydney, if I could just add to the other side of the argument, and I agree with everything about that, but one of the problems, if you're trying to build flexibility and modularity like that, you've got to have control of your requirements, because you're coming out with a new ship, and the requirements folks say it's got to carry every type of aircraft known to mankind. Well, then by extension, every ship we ever build is going to be an aircraft carrier, because you'll need the EMALs to launch them. We can't afford to build aircraft carriers when all we need is a frigate. But if you put the space, weight, and power reservations in that ship, the requirements folks think, well, that's free. We're not even installing it. We're just reserving the space for it. But when you reserve the space for something you don't have yet, it means you can't use that space for something you need now. The ship grows bigger and bigger. So that modularity is great as long as you've got control of the requirements. So it's not a cure-all for the requirements process. It's still everything acquisition starts with requirements. And when you say, I want a space, weight, and power reservation, you have to make sure you're doing that for all the right reasons. Otherwise, it'll come back and bite you.
Well, you also have to set the standards for the architecture. So if you're talking netted weapon sensors and platforms, okay, you know, that's how we fight across the joint force. Right, we net our weapon sensors and platforms. We pass information between those sensors to shooters. And so we need to identify, so it's one thing to have the requirements, but when that interoperability and integration piece needs to be stressed such that you can now build that agility into those things because you're just putting apps onto it or giving it more capability that's pacing the threat.
All right, somebody else think a question up. I have one for the August panel, and it goes to the,
there we go.
Good. I'll save my question.
By all means. Sorry, sir. Lieutenant Junior Grade Davidson, communications officer on USS Spruance, and Marshall Scholar 2013, USNA 13. I had a question specifically for you, Sir Admiral Lewis, regarding C4I. For the vast requirements of our ITs specifically, you mentioned that we need to focus more on training and operability. So is the answer then in in terms of procurement, that we need more operable systems? Or is the answer that we need to spend more time training? Or is the answer that we need to spend more time on personnel? And if that's the case, related, how do you reconcile requirements based by defense intelligence agencies on shore with no signals, signals issues, I guess, for ships?
Okay. I was communications officer on USS Spirit, so I wish you well.
Probably not the same Spirit.
Not at all.
it was the Omada Spirit.
So I had a chance to speak with a systems developer in the gaming industry. And their standard for training, their customer base, opens the box of the games, or if it comes in a box, downloads it, whatever, and that customer expects to be an expert in how to play that game in 10 to 15 minutes. If it takes longer than 20 minutes to learn how to play the game, the customer throws it away and tells all their friends it's a bad game, and they don't sell any. So out there in the world is a very sophisticated set of engineers who deliver to that requirement. And I think we can do the same thing. Admiral Richardson was involved in a project, can I talk about Tang? Project Tang, how to run things in a submarine control room. And he required that no one above the rank of lieutenant or older than the age of 30 participate. And I went through the Tang mock-ups at a company not to be named in Northern Virginia, and it was pretty impressive. Things that we had taken for granted, I had taken for granted, and I've been doing this a long time, the 28-year-old lieutenant said, no, we don't do it like that. One that strikes me is in the Virginia weapon system, there's a very complicated, very expensive weapons controller thing, got knobs and buttons all over it. And the suggestion was, why don't you just use a $29 Xbox controller? What if it breaks? Plug another one in, throw it away. So it went from a $100,000, $150,000 device to a $29 device in a closet full of replacements. And I think that's the kind of approach. I won't give you the answer to your question. That's the kind of approach that we need to be looking at our communication system is. Our target audience are ensigns and JGs and 22 to 28-year-old petty officers. What's it going to take for those people to string together a worldwide satellite communication system and make it work classified, encrypted at some data rate? And I'll tell you, if a gaming company can put together some of the games out there and deliver that level of performance, which they can, they've proven it, we should be able to do the same thing. So it's been proven. It's not new. It can be done. We need to bring it into our culture, back to the culture question, and start with the customer in mind, the warfighter in mind, and work our way backwards. That's what Admiral Richardson did with Tang. That's what industry does, the gaming industry does, and I think we can do the same thing.
So talk to me about open architecture, rapid tech insertion, and the ability for the system to fail quickly so that you can recover and implement technology faster. Mr. Moore.
I was going to pass that to the Marine Corps. No, I'm sorry.
We're going to start at this end.
Make sure you have enough reserve buoyancy.
That's right. Yeah. Man, we're going to get into metacentric height here in a minute with Joe. So, you know, I think this is kind of a payloads or a platforms question. I think if you go look at, say, the surface Navy and, you know, my first couple of ships that I served on with a Mark 26 launcher and you go look at where, you know, I was on an Adams class destroyer and we were decommissioning these ships at, you know, 25 years in, and not because we don't know how to maintain a ship from a hull mechanical standpoint for a long time. We do it on a carrier for 50 years. We were getting rid of the ships because the combat system became obsolete. And so with the when we got open architecture with SPY and we got vertical launch, which allowed us to really, from the missile standpoint, allowed us to change the weapon system as we went along, we all of a sudden figured out, hey, we can take DDG-51 and we can do all sorts of things with it. And I don't think anybody in their right mind, when DDG-51 first came in the line, if you'd said back in 1987, hey, by the way, it's going to be our primary ballistic missile defense platform in the 30 years from now, you would have got a lot of weird stares. But the reality of it is today. So open architecture and providing things like vertical launch and providing a platform that has a lot of power generation and can distribute that power around allows you to then experiment, innovate, and try new technologies, which maybe they won't work, and that's okay. In fact, we should be, a lot of the discussion today and, some of the culture discussion, talked about the fact that, we're a fairly risk-averse organization. I would argue if you can get the platform right with open architecture that you can innovate a lot more and take a lot more risk and not be afraid of making a mistake every now and then, because when you make a mistake, you learn from that and then turn right around in a tighter learning circle and get something new on board.
I just want to note for the record that Vice Admiral Moore is praising DDG-51 and Dave Lewis is praising aircraft carriers. So just
for the record.
So the reason, why was the Hornet like it was? The Hornet was like it was because the ship designers, it was like it was because the airplane designers wouldn't abide by the ship designer rules. The airplane guys kept making bigger, faster, heavier airplanes. And it took 4, 5, 6 years to build a ship. And in that time, the airplanes all changed. And this was very frustrating for the ship design guys because they couldn't get the requirement right because they were trying to design for a point airplane, a particular airplane. And the epiphany that happened, the breakthrough in the late 30s in aircraft carriers design, was that the airplanes were never going to stop changing. So stop designing for a particular airplane and start designing to the interface, the ICD, we would call it today an ICD, interface control document. Kind of draw a box and say, well, they're not going to get any bigger than this. And so that sets your elevator. They're going to burn this kind of gas, so that decides whether you use an avgas or JP whatever. They're going to land. They have to land at about this speed, so that means the wires have to be able to take this and that. And so now you have like 3 or 4 parameters, Joe was talking about, and then you design a ship around those 4 things. And as long as you've picked the right size box, the right level of parameters, you're good. And those aircraft carriers designed in the 30s and 40s lasted until the 60s and 70s. Well, actually, Midway went 47 years right out here. And it went from launching F-2F Wildcats to shoot down Japanese Zeros to launching F-18s with that philosophy. I think that's impressive. I mean, they launched airplanes that had never even been thought of when that ship was designed. That's amazing. And I would tell you that the smartphone you have in your pocket today is doing things today that the designers of that smartphone never even imagined. And it's because they didn't over-specify the requirements and they focused on the interfaces and left that a little bit vague and open. And then the creativity of this other community, app developers or airplane developers or whatever, was allowed to play in a very large space. And that's when innovation happened. If you lock it down, like the Yamato 18-inch gun, all of a sudden the only thing you have is whatever comes out of an 18-inch gun. And there aren't a lot of things that can come out of an 18-inch gun except for like a big bullet. And that's it. And so suddenly you don't have any design space. You don't have any options. It's a big bullet that takes 3,000 Gs. That's a pretty small box to work in. But an arresting gear and an elevator and maybe a catapult, that's a pretty big box to work in. So I just offer that back.
I'd
Yeah, this brings up the ongoing debate between acquisition costs and lifecycle costs, because what Dave just described is a concept called the flexible ship concept, which is out there. They cost about 5 to 6% more in acquisition costs, but unless it's specified as a requirement right up front, you're never going to get it, because part of that big acquisition process is the value engineering that says drive the costs out of this product. And so the first thing to go will be the flexibility of that flexible ship. But on the life cycle, if you can keep from having to recapitalize that ship because it's built to be flexible, it's built to be modular, it's built to have upgrades within its lifespan, and you're not recapitalizing the whole thing at 25 years, you can take it to 40 years, then suddenly there's a big life cycle savings. But it's always tough because the acquisition costs are right here and right now. They're present value costs versus a future value life cycle cost, which is down the road. So that's coming to grips with what is really the deciding factor. Is it the life cycle or is it the acquisition?
Dave, I want to thank you for reminding me that my first aircraft carrier is now a museum.
You're welcome.
So we talked a little bit about point designs against set-base designs. Requirements that drive acquisition and are very, very specific about what they need compared to something that's more broadly based. We write requirements for various weapon systems. We try to make them, you know, capability-based. I need something to do this. And when we write the big R requirements, the KPPs and KSAs, that flows then down to their organizations to write the specs. And then, so if you have a lot of KPPs and a lot of KSAs, key system attributes, key performance parameters, that's going to turn into volumes and volumes of volumes of information that now goes to a contractor to now compete this product. And then every single one of those, it must, it shall, it will, turns into a test parameter. And all those things lead to, takes too long, costs too much. So we need to go through our requirements documents with a rake. Keep it simple. Here's what we need, a system to do this. And absolutely then you want to build agility into whatever the this is. And so the way to do that is through open architecture, open system architecture, software reprogrammable payloads. Those kind of things that are becoming the norm is what is how we get those systems out there. Because if you aren't feeling the sense of urgency, the adversary gets a vote. And we can't take years and years and millions of dollars to get systems out to the fleet.
So the only thing I would offer is from the disruptive thinking corner, relative to IT, I think it's a question of how, because it's changing so fast, the technology turn is changing so fast. How do we allow technology to drive the requirement instead of allowing the requirement to drive the technology? Because that's, in the IT world, that's what it seems to, that's kind of the way I'm processing it as I go and meet with the MC3 guys. And you know, you'll run into young Marines out in the fleet and they'll say, hey, sir, check this out, what I can do on my tablet. And it's, you know, it's that technology. We never even thought of it until the young Marine shows us, and then it's like, well, that's a requirement for us to be able to do that. So it's a question of how do we allow the technology in the IT world to drive the requirement instead of the other way around?
See, I'd say write a requirement that allows for the easy ability to be able to insert technology into it. If you're chasing a technology or you're chasing something else, like, you know, the pull-push type thing, you can get yourself, and then you know how long it takes to get a requirement through the building? Right? That takes too long and costs too much. So I guess what I'm saying is there's an art into how we write our requirements such that we can do exactly what you said, which is get that new technology inserted into it without having to redo all the requirements documents.
Sir.
Yes, good afternoon. So Jeremy Rocket with IBM Security. So partly on that note, this is partly for Brigadier General Shrader, but I'd be curious if any of the other
Wait, IBM yeah. asking me a question. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
If my mother were here, she'd be proud. My kids. Go ahead, man. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
You can tell your kids.
I have an iPhone 5C, by the way. That's how old I am. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
That's all right. The question is this. In light of trying to speed up the acquisition process, I know about the cyber acquisition team under Harry Oldland, PMM110, I believe. I wondered if that initiative and that group is continuing to expand. Is that an initiative that's going to continue to grow for cyber acquisition specifically? Yeah. And then secondly, is there any other similar initiative within the Navy? Because I know that's specific to the Marine Corps.
Yeah, so the cyber acquisition team that we stood up within Marine Corps Systems Command was an effort to try to, I would say, close the seam or close the gap between defense business systems, which is basically what Harry has in 110, and our tactical systems, which is in PM, command and control and communication systems. And as cyber was laid at our feet and how we're going to deal with that, every time we would get a requirement that would come in, it seemed like we needed something that allowed program managers to execute their programs and not get caught up in trying to work with the requirements folks to develop the requirement and figure out where it needs to go and all that. So that's what it's an enabler to figure out how we transition the requirement over to the right program office. It's going to continue. It has legs. What I would say is from the Marine Corps side of the house, we are looking at a deputy commandant for information. I think that's out there. Folks know that. So that's how serious we're taking. And what that portends for cyber, we don't know yet. I don't know yet, but I think that's something to watch too. So the CAT team will continue. It still has utility, but it's just an enabler to feed the transition of the requirement into one of those two program offices.
Got it. Is that it does, and I'm curious if there are other similar initiatives within the Navy. If anybody knows what.
I don't know that we have any. I mean, the Navy a couple years ago, the Spey War in particular, and NAVC worked pretty hard to kind of define, you know, from the cyber side of the house, where's the dividing line? Where's the responsibility? And the two SysComs, you know, working with N2 and 6 have been given very broad authority from the cyber side of the house to go manage cyber. NAVC on the HM&E platform, common system side, and I'm Lewis on the information system C4I side of the house. So it's about setting up standards. It's about, you know, building the requirements up front when you build these systems and then going to work on the systems that we already have to kind of at least make them as minimize the vulnerability that they have today. So while I don't think we have a cyber assist team, I think the Navy is organized pretty well right now underneath OpNav to go manage the ships and systems that are going on our ships today.
I agree with that.
Thank you.
Sure.
Bob Shea with SCIA. I think you've got absolutely the right approach when you're talking about the software, you know, the defined radio, software-defined networks, and things of that nature. The question I've got is particularly where you've got this crossing over commercial software in some cases with government-built software, how do you deal with a software assurance issue from a cyber perspective? Mm. So much is being developed offshore. I mean, I've always worried about that with Aegis and things like that. If you got a different, if your software was telling you the attack was coming from a certain direction, certain speed, certain altitude, and it was off by just 2 degrees because of something somebody had done.
So to continue what Evan Moore was talking about is, and to talk about what I discussed in another forum today at this conference is we have fully embraced the NIST, National Institute of Standards and Technology, cybersecurity framework, standards. Go to the NIST site, 800 series, and take a look, and you will see the Navy's plan for dealing with cybersecurity in its entirety. We've tweaked it up a little bit, so what we use is not unclassified. It's not It's not open, published, it's distro D, which means it's limited distribution. For clear defense contractors, you can get a copy. Come see me. I saw Ron Fritzemeyer in the back there somewhere. Stand up, Ron, there he is. So we've adapted them slightly for our environment, but it is a standards-based approach to cybersecurity. If you want to do host-level protection for a computer, there's a standard for host-level protection for a computer. It has 95 control statements in it. So when we look at HBSS would be the commercial term for it, host-based security system. You're selling me an HBSS, and some other guy's selling me an HBSS. I take those 95 statements, and I bounce yours and theirs. And you do 90 of them, and he does 15. I do a risk assessment, and then we pick one that meets all requirements. It might be the one that does 15 because they're the most important 15. But it's a standards base. It's not a sales brochure. It's not he gave a better brief than you. It's a standards-based selection process. And it's the nice thing about NIST is I don't pay to maintain those standards. Industry does that. The NIST does that. It's free to me. And they're vetted through industry, all of the academics, all of the engineers. There's a very good process for creating those, and they're updated regularly. The HLP standard, I think, has been updated three times in my 3 years at Spaywar, twice in my 3 years at Spaywar. So they're current, they're modern. As the threat changes, the standards change. They add standards, and all of the syscoms are following those in doing our cyber security engineering and design. And that's how we address that. It includes logistics, it includes architectures, it includes everything. You still have the issue with buying things. You know, where do you buy your chips? I spoke to a chip manufacturer, and they have a price sheet, and the same chip, same part number, you get to pick where it's made. And the price is dependent on where it's made. And the good prices come from places that we don't want them made there. So the buyer, the GS5 buyer, has to be cyber aware to know not to buy the cheapest chip on the price sheet, okay? They have to know where to buy it from. And so that's an awareness thing. And I think in the end, everybody in government and industry and defense will have to have a fairly high level of what you just talked about, knowledge and awareness of those issues.
Sir.
I'm Kurt Hamill from Esri. First of all, I want to thank you all. We know that you're the ones that are lifting this heavy burden and trying to solve it, and it's a tough nut. Could you talk about the Digital Warfare Office? This is a new group that stood up, and then especially since it's an acquisition panel, talk about how the great ideas coming out of the Digital Warfare Office are actually going to get productized and out in the fleet.
So Digital Warfare Office came out of Task Force Netted Navy, which was run by N2N6. And it really gets to the interoperability and integration of all of our weapon sensors and platforms. Digital Warfare Office is going to be working closely with N9I. Matter of fact, we're going to co-locate them in the Pentagon in the same office space. So we're N9I is working with the fleet, doing N9 type stuff. Digital Warfare Office is going to be working with industry, with academia, to come up with identifying what are those standards that we're going to be using for our systems to make sure that they are interoperable, that we're able to integrate them onto our weapon sensors or platforms, and that they're also, as part of the N2N6 organization, will be working closely with Admiral Lewis's team to make sure that we have the proper protections of our systems as we move forward. So it's just getting started. Fairly small office right now, and I think they're going to targeting a few key high return on investment areas, and then we'll see and continue to learn and grow the office as we walk through it.
Do they get to test them? Yeah.
Do they get to test them?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
I've been hard on tests today.
No, as a former tester.
He's been awfully hard on testing. We have time for one more question, sir.
Good afternoon, gentlemen. Rob Alameda from Rolls-Royce Naval Marine. In an effort to add greater value and service our products to our customers globally, additive layer manufacturing or 3D printing is obviously a technology that we're investing in, as well as our competitors in the industry. And just curious as to what extent the U.S. Navy is investing in this technology. I mean, we're finding that it's always very, it's obviously very expensive, and your requirements and the U.S. Navy requirements are very specific. So I'm just curious as to what extent we're investing in that. Thanks.
Yeah, so it's a great question. I mean, almost everywhere I go today, any warfare center or naval shipyard, the first thing they want to take me is to their additive manufacturing, their 3D printer. So I think there's great value for us there, but I also think we have to embrace the technology, but we have to be careful about it as we move forward. So a lot of things that you see in additive manufacturing today is, you know, somebody will show, hey, I built out of plastic this little widget, you can attach it to the to your walkie-talkie so that the antenna doesn't break off, and this, okay, and that's great. But, and, you know, maybe Navier can talk a little bit more, but if you're talking about building a part for a catapult or for a critical pump on the ship, I think we have to make sure that we've got a set of standards and that we've gotten some technical oversight to the process as we start developing the technology. I think we're going to do that because the possibilities are pretty endless. For instance, you know, if you could, you're back to the cyber thing. Once you build this digital package, and you can trust that package, we can do a lot of things with it going forward. But the technology right now is in its infancy stages. I like to tell my staff it's kind of like, you know, when you had dot matrix printers. And you had paper in the box, and it kind of spooled up. And you thought, well, I can print. I'm lucky if I print 3 pages a minute. Then went to color printers, and the first color printers were 2 pages a minute. Now I'm doing, you know, I can do 100 pages a minute on a color printer. So I think we have to embrace the technology. We have to stay on top of this because I think eventually the capability is going to print parts faster than we do today is going to catch up with our need to have the parts quicker. Today provides an ability to provide maybe emergent support for a part on the ship that you just don't have on the ship at the time. But we're not to the point, I've heard people talk about the fact that, hey, we won't have to have a supply system. We'll just put 3D printers on the ship, and anytime I need a part, I'll make it. That's a, you know, I think that's a fairly futuristic vision, and so I think that would be nirvana if you could get there. But we're not there today. It's something we've got to keep working on. We've got to have established standards working on going forward. And I think, but it's a technology that we're embracing today. And you're going to see more and more of that to come on, you know, on the NAVSEA side of the house. And if Admiral Grossclaugs is here today,
yeah,
maybe
Admiral
Dunaway can talk about it. Yeah. I think Navier is probably 10 years ahead of where NAVSEA is on this. In fact, they've already figured out how to use this for flight critical parts. So,
no, he'd agree with you 100%. I've heard him answer that question.
So when I was there at Navier, you could not swing a dead cat without hitting somebody that had a machine that could additively manufacture something. The question is, the materials are evolving so quickly, and the processes by which these machines lay up the material is evolving so quickly that you don't want to invest in it right now. Where we put all of our energy at Navair, and I know that they're still working it this way, is through the digital thread. Yep. And if you can keep the digital thread very well managed and maintained, then whatever advanced manufacturing technology comes along next, because it may or may not be additive, is the way to go. Now, the parts are going to be produced in multiple materials that are complex wherever you want to produce them in the future. We're not there yet. We need to shape that as we go forward.
Yeah, sir, if I could add one more thing on top. So there's a cyber element to this that we have to be very, very careful about, because eventually your parts are going to be in these data packages. And if someone could change a one or a zero on this package, you could have a machine that builds a part that you would look at it, and it would pass almost every test that you had, but that part could just have a minor flaw built into it that you would not know about. So I throw that out there. I'm a full proponent of additive manufacturing, but there's a cyber element to this that we got to be very, very careful about as we move forward.
So I'd just like to add, from Marine Corps perspective, our Commandant's leading the way on additive manufacturing, 3D printing, all the way through DCINL, to the point where at Marine Corps Systems Command, we came up with procedures and put them out in a MAR admin, where if a unit, so we have 3D printers now at the maintenance battalions, down at the repair battalions, if you will. If a unit thinks that they need, that they have a case where they need to print a repair part, they send the request to the program manager that owns the product, and they ask, can I print this? The engineer, the lead engineer on the program office, looks at it and determines whether we have the tech data package, the rights to print it. The lawyers look at it and see if we're going to get sideways in that area. And then they go back and they let them either print it or not. So we're doing it. We're doing it where it makes sense. The other thing I would offer is we have some cases where we have saved some, I would say, some real money. I mean, it's Marine Corps, so a dollar is real money for us. So, but there's a case where our EOD techs needed an extraction tool for pulling mortar rounds out of a mortar tube, and they were forward deployed. Their tool was broken. They sent in and said, hey, can we print this thing? We allowed them to print it, and the program office now is printing these things. They cost about $80 to print one, where when we bought them off the market, they were in excess of $600. So, I mean, that's a perfect case of where we're doing it. We're heavily into 3D printing and a potential second source of supply for repair parts and stuff. There is the safety aspect, safety of flight, safety of use, you know, is it critical to the vehicle and all that kind of stuff. But that's why we have the engineers looped into the whole process to approve it. So we're leaning forward in 3D printing, the Marine Corps.
Well, we want to thank you for being an engaging audience, and I think the panel deserves a round of applause. Thank you.
Well, on behalf of the United States Naval Institute and FC International, we thank the entire panel, Admiral Dunaway, Admiral Moore, Admiral Lewis, Admiral Baffer, Admiral Miller, and General Shrader. Superb panel, great discussion, wide-ranging, and we appreciate that your time is precious, and we thank you for sharing your experience and your wisdom with us today. Thank you again. Let's give them one more hand.